consequence, you know, we gathered an impression that, you know, something more is required to be given on the Companies Act 2013. And that's why we have got a very interesting session to end this study course. We have a very eminent person, Mr. Hasmukh Dedhia, Chartered Accountant, to speak on, you know, very important aspect of Companies Act. He has taken sort of case studies of some of the important key aspects of Companies Act. Incidentally, he is the Vice Chairman of the Corporate Member Committee, which is organizing this seminar. So we are indeed fortunate to have with us him. A very busy professional. In fact, even though he is involved in structuring of this program, he was not able to participate. So I said the right way to get him would be to invite him as speaker. And that's how he is here. To briefly introduce Hasmukh Bhai, he is a chartered accountant and of course DSA, that is System Audit Diploma of Institute. He is a member of the Institute since 1981. He has been faculty and paper writer of several seminars, workshops held by WSORCI, IRDA, Chamber of Tax Consultant, other organizations, CBOCA and other organizations, including Chamber of Commerce and Industry Association. He was lecturer in Advanced Accountancy and Tax in VES College of Commerce and Economics for about 4 years in the past. Currently, he is a partner of Kinji Guwagi & Company, a reputed firm of Chartered Accountants. With over 25 years of professional expertise in handling audit, consultancy and business restructuring assignments for several clients in public as well as private sector, including SME clientele, etc. He possesses vast experience in audit of several listed and large government organizations. He specializes in audit and financial due diligence of insurance, mutual funds and other specialized financial services organizations. The other professional social activities are his president, past president of CPO, Chartered Accountant, Post Accountant. He was the president of the organization in the year 2006-07. Served WRCO-ICI as corporate member on several subcommittees. So Chamber of Tech Consultant currently, as I mentioned, he is the Vice Chairman of this committee and several other charitable and philanthropic organizations. We are fortunate to have Mr. welcome you and request Mr. Harish Pinya, the Council Member, to present him a memento. Good evening, friends. One of the definition of guest, which I know of, it says that guest is one who makes the host being feel at home. Like many definitions in the company law are kind of verbalized. So here, I see myself as whether I am a guest, am I a host? Yes, I should have been a host. I am part of the organizing team. Unfortunately, because of the comparative reasons, I couldn't make it to the earlier sessions as part of organizing team. But as you all know, Google by being very tough taskmaster, who knows what to expect from whom and when. He made me come here in the end. Going through the details of the course, I understand we have covered over past 10 sessions many areas in a greater details, and therefore it was thought pertinent that rather than now looking into areas, let us look back that areas that we have already looked in and what are possible, probable, future, potential questions as well as opportunities for us, the professionals and practice people. And therefore the whole structure under the guidance of, under the very able guidance of Vipul Bhai and with the help of my colleague Saurabh, who's assigned me
What we have done is we have framed about 20 odd case studies. We will look into this, and through that we will look into the some of the fine-tuned drafting nitty-gritties of the new law, and through that we will try to, you know, like expand our horizons of our understanding that we have already learned over the last 10 sessions. When I am saying this, friends, one request I may have to make is that I was personally given to understand that this is not a lecture meeting, and therefore we shall try to make it as interactive as possible. Although 20 odd questions are here, but let's not confine to that. If arriving from these questions or attempting to find the solutions of these questions, if some more questions arise, please do not hesitate to interrupt me. Let's discuss that. It is not necessary that I or anybody else, or for the matter today, have all the answers. What is more important is that you know all the questions, you are open to all the questions. The way, the hurry and the haste in which the new law has been brought. Originally it took more than 10 years to re-qualify the law, and thereafter to make it effective, some undue hurry was done. It's coming into effect in parts, still a major part, almost to say one third part is not yet operative, but most of the part with which we professionals have to deal in day in day out is now effective, and therefore we shall be looking into that, because we have, our clock has started tick 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 from 1st April. Therefore we need to know some of these questions. We need to pick into the possible or a potential areas of concern for all of us. With that, friends, I understand the time of about little less than 90 minutes. I think we should be in position to cover most of the area, because this is something that we already know of the basic provisions, and therefore we are looking at it. The first is, when a new law comes, obviously there are some action points. Here, the law came in somewhere in the, the majority of the clarity, like the rules came in the big end of March, 2nd, 3rd, and we were told that from 1st April 2014 the law is effective, or the substantive part of the law is effective. So therefore, it may be of interest for us, it may be of interest for corporates to know what is it that I have to do. How does my life change from 31st March 2014 to 1st April 2014? So what is it that I need to do immediately? I believe there is a full-fledged session after this, so I am not going to this in very great details, but very few action points for your consideration. Starting from simple and small thing, where we would not like to afford to miss out or be on the non-compliance, is printing of PIN on every bill, invoice, letterheads, official documents of the company, etc. Mind you, this is effective from 1st April 2014, and the penalty, strangely, is for non-compliance is 1,000 rupees per day. That's strange for such a small business, but that nonetheless it is there. If you have not done it, okay, in the first year, nobody will say this. So clearly in the first year, some of these provisions will be perhaps taken, not so stringently, may be taken a bit, the delinquency will be there. So let's not delay. If you have not done this already, let's start doing it as fast as we can. It may involve some printing cost, but nonetheless, for the compliance of the law. Mentioning DIN also, in returns and many other official documents that we file or that we upload onto the corporate listing, the DIN of directors. Not in all cases, but in some cases, there could be a case of looking at our age-old memorandum and articles or articles, memorandum articles of association. Many a times, sorry to say this, but many a times what happens is when you form a company, apart from main object, the rest of the memorandum and articles is copy-paste of some other company which we have formed earlier. It is already there on the computer, so Ctrl-C, Ctrl-V happens. Nothing wrong in that. But let's look at it from the angle or perspective of the new Companies Act, is there anything in our old memorandum or in old article which we perhaps may need to see and therefore change? Some of you may be aware that some of the large companies have already kind of revised their, in process of revising their memorandum and articles. Reliance, for instance, has already in the AGM has put in a special resolution, special business of, you know, revision of the entire article. They have put it on their website. It may be of interest for some of you who are interested in the topic to make a reading of it. One very important aspect is, as on 31st March, I mean, somebody asked me, what, I mean, how is it that as a director, I am running a private company, how is it my life changes? Tell me, what's the difference? The first thing I point it out as is, look at your liability side. Knowingly or unknowingly, you may have accepted and recorded something as a liability which from 1st April would need a relook. There's a separate question on this aspect, so I'll not deal with that in detail. But this is the most important part from the professional's point of view, from the chartered accountant's point of view. Whether you are helping company on the management side or whether you are auditor of the company, this is an important aspect or an action one which we must do immediately as early as possible. Speaking of loans and advances which company has given, what we have seen in the earlier bullet is on the liability side. This may be on the asset side. Again, there would have been some action in the past, which now requires a fresh look in the light of the new provisions. Internal financial control is an area on which one can speak for about an hour and still not complete it. This is an area where in most of the companies, your company is small, big, large, commensurate to the size of the company and nature of that business, we might have to advise the company either as a managed part of the management, part of the consultant or part of the auditor to look into what areas that they need to strengthen as part of internal financial control. Because even the smallest of small company, even a private company, in its director's report you have to give this a proactive statement that company has effective internal financial control with reference to financial statements and these controls are operating effectively. And auditor will also, in the audit report, will have to make a proactive report on this statement whether the IFCs of the company are effective and operational actually. And that time will come probably in 31st March 15 when we are doing 15 audits somewhere in next June. So we have time, most of the companies, we have time of say 9 to 11 months. So let us utilize this time to look into, to look back into our control systems, our internal check systems, our internal audit system, our MIS flowing from ground to board level and see how we can strengthen. There are no hard and fast rules of what should be done, what should not be done. It will be dependent on case to case basis. Like I said, time of 9 to 11 months, but that time is not there for listed companies, because listed companies will be doing June quarterly limited reviews and many of them do audit. Infosys, for example, does a quarterly audit. ICICI Bank, for example, does a quarterly audit. So their audit report we will be finding in July. So they are, these are the auditors who are grappled with these issues, what to do about the IFC, how to report it in the audit report, because these accounts and audit related provisions have come into effect from 1st April 2014. 31st March 14, we were given a clarity by MCA itself that all provisions related to old act, not new act. Quarter audit June 14 would be a new act. So therefore, IFC is an important part to look into for the action points. Related party transactions, as you know, new law has many, many changes. Some of them are very far reaching. The definition of related party, the coverage of the transaction, going far ahead of what we are used to under the old law. Therefore, that also can be counted as one of the action points as to how do we re-look at it in the light of the fresh provisions, act and the rules, so that we are knowingly or unknowingly not on the wrong side of the law. Strengthening of internal MIS depending on the size of the company. We are dealing with the companies where, you know, it's husband wife director's company or two brothers director company or father's a director company. So really no big MIS, no big deals. The owners are almost there on the head of the company every operations. But think of a medium sized company which has maybe two manufacturing locations, office in Bombay and two manufacturing locations in somewhere in Maharashtra, somewhere in other state. Would you not like to have your MIS strengthened so that you get proper, sitting at the top as a board or as a top management, get a proper reporting of happenings at the ground level in such a way that you are able to comply with the provisions, the difficult provisions of the Act. So private and unlisted companies will have to gear up for preparation and presentation of two things. One is cash flow statements, another is consolidated financial statements if they have a subsidiary. Now earlier, unlisted companies having a subsidiary were not required to prepare consolidated. But now, because that consolidated financial statement requirement emerged from listing agreement, now you have that. So therefore, it's not as if you wait in financial year end and then start doing it. Start preparing your cash flows, start preparing your CFS if you have a subsidiary for the year ended 31st March 14, because when you will be doing that in the 15th for the first time, you will be requiring the previous year number. So it will help you two ways. You are prepared for it. On the way to prepare for it, if there are any questions, if there are any obstacles, if there are any issues, you have ample time to, you know, take proper advice, to go in a proper manner and get prepared, get ready for it before you arrive at the March 15th for it. Last bullet, of course, is applicable to some companies which are very large, setting up the audit committee, nomination and remuneration committee, stakeholders committee, CSR committee, wherever it is applicable, wherever your size is enough, either you are a listed company or your capital network, etc., turnover, etc., matches those particular things. So that last bullet is for those large companies. But all others are applicable to all companies. So I thought we'll have a bird eye view of these section points. I'm sure that I may be missing out on many small procedural compliance secretarial related issues, but I'm told that there's already a session which will deal with this. But this is broadly a bird eye view of an action point that we need to take immediately. When we take this action point, it automatically takes us into the knowledge of the requirement of the new provisions, and therefore we become kind of ready for it. That friends takes us to next case study. Some of you are aware that the law as it was passed in the parliament was very, very unfair to the private limited companies. When I say private limited companies, I mean absolute private limited companies, companies which are not subsidiary of any public company. But, I mean, earlier there were so many privileges, exemptions and relaxations under the old law that a private company could and did enjoy. Like in practice, or for a moment if you lift the corporate veil, what is a private company? It is not an extension of a family business. There is no involvement of a public firm. There is no public interest coming there. Then why do we have so much restrictions and so many compliance requirements on such companies to such an extent that their business itself will die? Fortunately, the representations were made, ministry was seized of the many of the issues. I am proud to say that Chamber of Tax Consultants itself was also part of those representations. I am more proud to say that my firm, Khinji Kohlji & Company, took an initiative as early as in the month of April end. Since then we have been in touch with some of the, you know, ministries, and last month only a meeting with a member of parliament to the chartered accountant from Bombay happened in our office, where representatives from most of the organizations like WRC, Chambers, CCS and many other CAs including Big Four were there. They all, you know, made their concerns known to the member of parliament. He took the initiative at a very right time. A meeting happened with the ministry, and perhaps in One week's time after that meeting, this circular which I am referring to in this table came up. I have been requested by Sharmaji to deal with this circular of relaxation to private companies, little bit in detail. So let's see very quickly. The first one is kinds of share capital, equity and preference. That is for normally for the company. Private companies, even earlier under the old law, could have issued any other third type of. It could have issued equity share with a differential voting right. It could have issued something which is neither equity nor preference. All that, that liberty was there. Because it was my money, I was issuing it to myself. Or to maybe the group of the shareholders who are there with me. So now that restriction which was there is kind of removed. And position under the old act more or less remains. The voting rights also, it's not necessary that I may have some shares with voting rights disproportionate to holding. I may have some shares with either no voting rights or maybe differential voting rights. So that is also now permitted to me. The next big realization came in the line of further issue of capital and a private placement. We all know that there has been a substantial amendment in the private placement because of the abuse of the old law. Taken or done by Sahara Group, which is the case is so very well known, Supreme Court had to kind of take a very stern action on the promoter. What was the old law? It says that if you make an offer to less than 50 persons, you don't have to go through the procedures of Section 68 under the old law, which means prospectus. But it's proper to say that offer to 50 in what time? So therefore, offer was made by that group to lakhs of people. In a year, every time ensuring that it is less than 50, which was clearly an abuse of law, that is now sorted out by the amendment. Since private placement will be a private placement if offer is made to less than 50% over a financial year. Now it is clear. But unfortunately, private companies were also dragged into it. So private companies, whenever it wanted to increase the capital, suppose two brothers, A and B are directors and promoters and the shareholders. Now the business is expanding. So some investor known to them wants to invest in this company. They have to do all these procedures of going, calling a general meeting, filing a letter of offer, doing special resolution, etc. For all this. Now, fortunately, all this is now not there. These provisions have been substantially relaxed for the private limited companies. Only a little procedural aspect of filing. After you allow the shares to somebody who is not your present shareholder, that remains. Now, ESOP is something which companies normally are required to issue with the authority of a special resolution. Private companies can do it with ordinary resolution. Not a big relaxation, but okay, something is there. The big relaxation comes in Section 73. We shall be seeing that in detail. Section 73 deals with acceptance of deposit by companies from members. That was something which was prohibited under the amended rules. Now, a relaxation has been given that and some conditions have been put that this can be done by some small private limited companies. So within private limited companies you have size under the circular. And those companies can now do this, accept the deposits from their members subject to these limits which are already there in this place. These are some of the secondary matters, section 101, 107, etc. Earlier also private limited companies were exempt, now 56 position is more or less brought in back. At item number 6 we have very important thing which may interest the auditors. Earlier, a chartered accountant could, under the company law, have audit of not more than 20 companies. While calculating that number of 20, we were not counting the private companies, we were not counting Section 25 companies, NGO companies, we were not counting branches of the foreign parents, etc. But the new law said 20, and in that there was no leeway given for not counting the private companies, and therefore it hit the profession very badly. Now that relaxation has been given by way of this notification, that in counting this maximum number of 20 audit per chartered accountant, private limited company will not be considered. Yes?
Sure.
I said that.
After the the proposed notification also, if you exactly see the wording of the section, if you are already an auditor of more than 20 companies, of only private companies, you will not be able to accept the audit of a single private public limited.
So you are now saying that rule is kind of overriding here.
Yeah, and the wording of the section are such that the 20 you have to count, but that time they are not saying that to exclude the public company. So if I have to accept the audit of a private public limited company, in the calculation of 20, the private also comes.
Therefore, this notification will be of help to us. It says that in counting 20, private limited companies to be excluded. All that what you are saying is very right, that rule in this case is kind of exceeding the act. In company law, I mean the way we see, at so many places, this has happened. The act was passed in the parliament, 12 September 2013, Lok Sabha passed it. And when Lok Sabha passed it, it may be of interest to some of you, those who were glued to TV on that day, I was. It passed in about 17 minutes. The Lok Sabha passed in 17 minutes. The number of members present in Lok Sabha were, I think, about 30 or so.
25, 30.
I'm counting speaker, ministers and all that. 30. Right? About 11 members spoke. They all spoke on CSR. No other matter. They were interested in CSR. No other matter. This is how the law was passed. So law is passed. Now suppose you were in place of a government, say secretary, ministry, or new minister. You are seized of the issue. You are seized of the practical difficulty. You want to give relief to the people. How do you do? To amend the law again, you have to go to parliament. It's the very lengthy process. So what do you do? Rule to hai mere paas. Rules mein whatever additional benefits, relaxations can be given, I am giving. So we have kind of stopped asking that rules are overriding act, that rules are giving something more. So long as they are giving benefit, okay, we are okay with it, at least we are getting something. Then you are at many places. If you see 185, it nowhere exempts the loan given by holding company to a subsidiary company. It restricts loan to be given by directors or entities in which directors are interested. So in case of a holding company, directors would obviously be interested in a subsidiary company. That was exempt earlier, 295 was giving exemption. Section, if you see the section act, it doesn't exempt. By rule, you have been given that exemption. Okay. If it is a loan from holding company to wholly owned subsidiary company, it will not be covered by section 185. So 185 doesn't say that. Rule is giving. At number of places you will find this. So therefore, though the benefit milta hai, lenge.
Even there the thing is only wholly owned subsidiary.
Yeah.
Only if 1% is held by somebody else, then it is not.
Then still. So that was so in the 56 years also. We can't ask something which was not there earlier. Okay, but that will create a problem. We have a case study of that. Some restrictions on power of board, that board cannot borrow, exceeding this, that. All those have been now relaxed for private companies having members less than 50. So more or less position of 1956 as far as restrictions on power of board is there. Then this requirement was there for public companies that when you are appointing directors, resolution for each director has to be passed separately. You can appoint three directors by one resolution. But that was not applicable to private company. Now that relaxation has been given. So 1956 position is restored. A very important relaxation is under section 185, which we all were kind of seeking, all were lobbying. Chamber's representation is also very nicely worded on that, has been partly heard. Why partly heard? Because what has come is, earlier there was an entire exemption from section 295 of 56 Act. Now this is coming with limits, which are very small limits, 50 crore and all. But nonetheless, something is given. This notification is also draft. Therefore, I would request all of you whichever association, trade association you are connected with, all your clients are connected with, ask them to give feedback as fast as possible. Let the ministries mailbox